No. No. No, 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 no. This is not my problem. Ah, bollocks.
Believe it or not, I actually spent an hour and a half filming my reaction to this comic, and I said nothing. I spoke, I produced words, but I said nothing. The entire hour and a half mostly consisted of me banging my elbow against this, complaining about my neighbours letting their shrieking wains outside to play at 9:30 in the evening, and continuously asking the camera what it wanted me to say. Now, I had a lot to say about Gotham High, mainly because of Melissa De La Cruz's sheer attitude, lack of research, and lack of respect towards the characters she was supposed to be adapting. I said, these are not your characters, you can't treat them like your characters. So I thought if she wasn't going to put in any effort and respect, then why should I? This one, however, I read interviews with Mariko Tamaki where she said that she was highly conscious of the fact that Starfire is a very beloved character and she had to keep that in mind. She had to respect that. She described it as playing with someone else's toys and all she wanted to do was to give them back in good condition. And I thought, yeah, she gets it. Whether or not this is a good work, she gets it. And she has done a little bit of graphic novel work for DC, so there is a bit of qualification and experience there, unlike some people. So I thought there's clearly no reason for me to read this because it's so obviously not for me. So if I don't like it, so what? And also, I got no time for this. I have home renovations to be taken care of, a full-time job, a long Halloween movie comic comparison to do, and a it looks to be hour-long review of the Titans show. Why would I spend my time on this? And by the way, the home renovations is what all this is about. I've just come back from stripping floors, so I apologize. But the press surrounding it came out and the sheer vitriol thrown at it, saying that it was woke nonsense and the end of comics, and the other side saying it's strong and brave and representative and all that other clickbaity nonsense. So I thought, maybe there is something in there worth talking about. So I read it, and no. It's not good, which I will get into, but it is bog-standard, trope-filled, low-effort, YA fluff that, though bad, seems to have been made in good faith. So unlike Gotham High, where the sheer disrespect made me endlessly unsympathetic to the work, this one is just bad. But that's all it is. It's a bad YA novel. It's a mediocre graphic novel. It's just nothing. It's nothing. But if it really is that important to the comic discourse, I will review it. But guys, if you're looking for a no-holds-barred bashing in the vein of what I did with Gotham High, sorry, you're not getting that. I will not be pulling my punches, but you will be getting something closer to the highly British levels of quiet exasperation that I displayed with the reviews of the worst of the DCAMU. So we start with Mandy complaining about how hard being the kid of a superhero is. First world problems at its finest. And we find out that Mandy doesn't have any powers, resents her mum, doesn't feel understood by her. So there is an honest attempt to focus on the mother-daughter relationship. And one positive thing I will say is that Starfire does seem to be a pretty decent mum here. Just trying her best, that she takes Mandy out into the sun to see if she has powers, but when she doesn't, and Mandy doesn't want to do it anymore, she doesn't push her, just tries to make her birthday as special as she can, talks to her about her education, tries to find another path for her. Let me be clear, this is not a perfect iteration of Starfire. It is still highly borrowing from her Teen Titans animated series representation, but there is a sincere attempt made here, and it's not god-awful. But fear not, negative Nancys, my generosity will not continue when we get to Blackfire. Or the other Titans, for that matter. So, back to the press surrounding this thing. Both sides of the argument, whatever the argument is, have said that this is great representation and the whatnot, or this is woke politics nonsense. It's neither. The book doesn't live up to the press surrounding it. It does say things about college and the system, but it's all very much portrayed as clueless teenagers who think they know everything talking out of their arses. One thing I do unironically appreciate is that, unlike Selina from Gotham High, who just went around treating both Bruce and Jack like utter shit, sleeping with both of them, snapping at them, emotionally abusing them, refusing money to make her brain-damaged father's life more comfortable because her pride was worth more than that, and yet is still portrayed as the rebellious heroine, Mandy is the bad guy here. And more importantly, the author knows it. Listen, teenagers are shite. It is the point in your life where you are at your worst. Everything is me, 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 and if you ask me to do my homework or sit in class and not disrupt other people and act like a decent human being, then you're the bad guy. So the failing here is not realism so much as a failure to make us feel for the character regardless. And that is quite a big writing failure. And while we're on Mandy, we have to take a look at the art. At times it's pretty good, and sometimes it's not. Although sometimes in comics you do get more effort put into some panels than others. I don't know if it's time constraints or budget constraints or just it happens. Not excusing it, but it happens. The best parts are the hyper-stylized panels surrounding Mandy's daydreams and inner emotions, which is good for a YA novel. When we get to the fight scenes, though, it becomes barely passable, let alone good. And Mandy herself? I am not one to pick at appearance. It's nasty, it's bitchy, and it's mean girlish. I don't care if you're a man, woman, boy, girl, it's mean girlish.
She's not pretty. I mean, that sounds bad, but whatever.
But Mandy is just so unpleasant to look at from a purely aesthetic sense. And for a visual medium, that is bad. Take my favourite comic, Hellblazer. God, why do I always bring everything back to John Bloody Constantine? This image is ugly. It is objectively horrendous, but it's also enthralling and interesting at the same time. However, there is a storyline where John is in prison and... oh God, it's just so ugly. I actively didn't want to look at it, and for me to genuinely want to close a comic over how unpleasant it was to look at, that's a real problem. There are so many panels of Mandy that invoke that same feeling in me. What is she, a vampire? What's going on with her teeth? So here's Lincoln. Not much to say about him, walking best friend trope. My friend Lincoln is convinced this is a cultural divide that happens between family generations born in different countries or universes. You used family as an adjective here? Between generations of families born in different countries or planets. Though my mum has stopped talking to me about my appearance, she hasn't liked how I look since I was 12. How I've looked since I was 12. The line between writing how teenagers talk with their bad grammar and just bad writing. An example of this is she uses like a lot, and I hate when writers do that, because even though people do talk that way, when you try writing it, it just gets in the way. So there's a lot of technical incompetence involved in writing this comic. It's also quite hard to read because we go from here to here to here and then speech bubbles in the middle. And what is this? What is this? If this is symbolic, I've no idea of what. I feel like I should be hearing that harp music that plays between transition scenes of old sitcoms. As for the plot, what do you want me to say? Mandy's a rebellious teenager, doesn't want to go to college, resents her mum, has a crush on a girl, hangs out with her, sticks it to her bitchy friends. Well, I guess I should actually look at that, since the sticking it to the bitchy friends is actually pretty weak. So it's like, aliens don't go to college. So if you're trying to do the bullying thing here, again, another YA trope that is so overused and has been done a lot better, a posh, preppy high school girl would probably say something like, oh, so you're not smart enough for college? Don't worry, not everybody can hack it in college. So Mandy takes the whole alien thing and says, I understand. No, Deb. We don't go to college. We undergo an initiation. A what? Yeah, it's pretty barbaric by Earth standards. A blood rite to defend the honor of my family. A battle that two enter and only one leaves. To win, I summon the powers of my ancestors. Then I will assume my true form, destroy my enemies or be ripped to shreds and tossed to the cosmos to rot among the stars. Seriously? No.
I believe that's what they call a mic drop.
So yeah, this is meant to be like Mandy's big FU moment to show how witty she is and how much of a badass she is, but no. So you want to know what happens? Every single teen drama you have ever seen happens. Name a trope, it is here. Seriously, guys, why are people even paying attention to this? Why? I will make a genuine effort to answer that by the time I'm done. But for now, the conflict, other than mum and daughter, is Mandy hates people that just want to get to her because of the Titans. Your mom's known Nightwing for like 20 years. He could totally be your dad. Could be Beast. Did we just cross universes? So Claire comes over. And for those of you who don't know, it is a long-running comic joke that Nightwing has the best ass in all of comics. And it's so pervasive it has now practically become canon. Every artist must draw Nightwing with a perfect arse. I'm completely fine with that. But this here, it just looks so off. The entire design of Dick and all the other Titans is so low effort and unappealing, but the arse itself, I can't believe I'm analysing an arse here, but the arse itself, it looks like, you know when writers draw boobs of such proportion that it just makes the character look awkward. This kind of invokes the same feeling. I don't exactly know what the artist was doing here, but it's bad. It's really bad. Worst Nightwing arse I've ever seen. So Claire takes a selfie with the Titans and it's like this massive betrayal. Why? She is a teenage girl who just met celebrities and Mandy never told her about any of her insecurities involving her mother's fame. But I guess a real life teenager would irrationally take this to heart, but it is one of those times that where Mandy is portrayed as being in the right to be hurt by this. It is portrayed like a genuine betrayal. But no, Mandy is overreacting. This is not a big deal. It's a weak conflict, and it is one of the many, many, many things that just serves to make Mandy look like a worse person. The other conflict, which should be more interesting but really isn't, is Blackfire. Oh, my poor, poor little psychotic tyrant, what did they do to you? She turns up because Starfire ran away after she conquered the planet, but Mandy still has a claim to the throne, so they have to fight. Now, I will say that all the stuff that happened to Starfire in New Teen Titans is a bit much and a bit too heavy for this comic. She was enslaved. Someone attempted to rape her. She was tortured. She was, oh, just so many awful things happened to her, and she managed to escape, and just that trauma just remained. You completely understand her running away. And even then, when Tamaran needed her, she still went back. She still fought Blackfire. She still kept fighting. Starfire is not one of my favorite characters. She's pretty in the middle in terms of characters I like, but if there is one thing she isn't, it's a quitter. And if there's one thing she definitely isn't, it's a coward. And this, even though I genuinely understand why they couldn't go all the way, does make Starfire look like a quitter. So meanwhile, Claire talks to Lincoln and he tells her why taking the selfie was a betrayal. It really wasn't. And the fate of a planet is hanging in the balance. Why are we still talking about this? So Starfire tries to defend her daughter and gets beaten, and the battle takes place on the school football field because I don't know. And seeing her mum get hurt and hearing Claire cheating for her unlocks her powers, which is just so cheap. I would have respected this comic a lot more if Mandy was just powerless, but they step on their own message because they were just too cowardly to go all the way with it. But oh, it gets worse. Mandy uses her powers to defeat Blackfire. Blackfire. For those of you who don't know, Blackfire is a better warrior than Starfire. Starfire is more powerful, but Blackfire is the better warrior. She had to be, because of a childhood illness that left her, by Tamaranian standards, disabled. She had to put her all into being a great warrior and being as ruthless as she became. Not saying that's what made her an evil person, she was definitely a terrible person from the get-go, but this is what makes her so freaking interesting, and oh my god, this character has just been simplified to the max over the years. And that's not specifically this comic's fault, but please god, will somebody just read New Teen Titans Blackfire and make her the way she used to be? So yeah, Blackfire is a very, very well-trained and talented warrior, and this untrained kid whose powers just emerged beat this freaking warrior queen. You know something? I honestly don't care. It is genuinely not worth my energy to care. Mandy wins, gets the girl, studies for the SATs, once again removing any interesting stuff they said about college, because I used my degree for fuck all. And genuinely do consider it 4 years wasted. But the difference is, university in Scotland is free. Seriously, you Americans, you pay extortionate levels of money for something so basic as an education. People in England do too, but not nearly as much as you do. I am so freaking sorry. And happily ever after, I guess? So, here's what I have to say. It is a bad graphic novel for the reasons I've stated. It is a bad YA novel because, contrary to popular belief, great YA novels, and great YA novels specifically for girls, can and do exist. I was highly, highly into comics when I was a teenager, but I did read novels and I did read the occasional YA novel, and seriously, there's this author called Jacqueline Wilson. She wrote books for teenage girls and they were so good. They portrayed real world issues in a way that prepubescent and pubescent girls could understand. I mean, she wrote a book about kids in a care home, about sisters with a loving but ultimately irresponsible mother, and just girls going through high school with their own very mundane home problems, and she managed to make them matter. So this stuff can be good. There's no reason it shouldn't be good, but it is just not good here. If I had a daughter, this is not something that I would think was worthwhile reading material for her. So yeah, it's bad. But is it worth the sheer visceral that it got? No. The problem is just the way the comic book industry is approaching this whole YA idea, and the problem with the comic industry in general. It's shit right now. But here's the thing, guys. This is our fault. In this social media age, clicks and articles and videos surrounding the topic matter. Any publicity is good publicity. If people are still talking about it, it will still exist. You want to help things? Buy from independent creators, watch things you love, talk about things you love. Ignore this. And on that note, this is the last of these YA novels I will be reviewing or addressing in any sense. I will be doing what I did with the Disney live-action remakes. Don't read, don't talk about, don't watch, don't engage. Let them die. I see.